The price of Nvidia will increase by up to $300 next year, but I'm selling all of my shares now. It's crucial to realize that there is no room for expansion, so if Nvidia keeps growing at this rate, it will be a one-and-done business. Monopoly and I at the hardware layer, and I believe that people are likely considering ways to mitigate that competitive outcome. However, that's what I took away from their announcement, which seemed to be like they were prepared to go for the jugular here in what appears to be the most significant market that's emerged in like what you think about the valuation chap at trading it 200 times or 50 times. Even I'm in your camp. The straightforward thing about price-to-equity ratios is that if you take the price-equity ratio and you invert it, that's your implied yield, it's probably between 2 and 2.5%, which is less than a nearly half of a typical 2-year bond. Consequently, when you have a yield this low, it must grow extremely rapidly. However, capitalism operates on the premise that when you grow to the point where you're making so much profit that rivals see you, they will look at you and say, "Hold on, you don't deserve that much profit. I'm going to take some of that. Your profit is my opportunity. Your margin is my opportunity." I believe that exactly what occurs is your margin becomes my opportunity. So I believe that I should be waiting for Freebird to happen in the next 2 quarters if AMD, if Facebook, Google, Microsoft, and Amazon don't make any significant announcements. There's a good chance that Nvidia will outperform them. My mistake is that you will start to see some real action in the upcoming 2 quarters, forcing people to adjust their forecasts so that Nvidia plus is the only option instead of just 100% Nvidia. That's sort of what I would bet because it seems reasonable and right, because if not, it would be pretty derelict of these hyperscalers to just throw their hands in the air and give them the entire market. The other issue is that, while AMD is a fantastic memory solution, they do not currently have a deterministic AI chip. Therefore, I believe Lisa Su needs to take decisive action and build something, announce something, or buy something, but she needs to be very aggressive in this regard. Additionally, tech analyst Dan Ives joined from Wednesday Bush, and his most recent note is available today. He is also present at Future Proof, where the FED is scheduled to begin reducing cycle plus. AI revolution indicates optimism. Tech trade ahead. You persuade me that trade is firmly back. I recently returned from my second trip to Asia in the last 6 weeks, so it's more firm. In fact, I'm becoming more and more bullish because of everything we're seeing in terms of chip demand, the use cases that will eventually power artificial intelligence, and the scale of hypers. I mean, in terms of Microsoft, I think this is just the beginning of the next leg. Given our perspective that the AI revolution is still in its early stages, I think there is a risk to the tech industry going forward. That being said, why has the chip trade been so erratic? In the end, I think there are legitimate concerns about demand softening, which is why we spend so much time in Asia. This speaks to the bullishness not only of Nvidia and Jens, the godfather of AI, but also of Microsoft when you consider the hyperscalers as a whole. That's why names like Palantir front and center, in terms of the use case names, where I believe many institutions kind of put it by the side, are front and center now. And you think there's enough that's not in the stocks, because a lot of what we're talking about is known and expected at this point, which is why the valuations and the prices have been bid up. It's Amazon and Google that's the foundation that's now what I've used. I mean, in our opinion, I believe Street's underestimating numbers across the board in tech 15 to 20% when you look out next 2 to 3 years, and that's you. Now that's really our thesis, is that as these use cases build out, you only have 3% enterprise that actually gone down the AI path. You have $1 trillion of AI capex coming in. Scott, I see it feed on the ground in Asia. And that's why I get the bears come out of hibernation mood, and you know, try to scare many. But I think when I look at tech, I believe this is a tech market that goes up another 15-20%, go into next 3 to 4 months. He's too bullish, or no, I so people were saying he was too bullish last year, and here's what's happened over the last year. Nvidia is the second best performer in the market, up 167%. People at the start of this year in January, they said, okay, now they're going to rotate away from the AI darlings, we're going to do something else. It's 8 months later, guess what? The number one performing stock of the year is NVIDIA, is tied with Vista Corp. They're both up 136%. So at a certain point, Nvidia can't be up 136% every single year. But this idea that we're all going to be smart enough to know when this is the top, and it's time to rotate out, it continues to fool people. NVIDIA continues to stay bid. I don't disagree that we're going to finish the year strong. In fact, I think the S&P can finish the year at 6,000, and it's going to be driven by tech. I think what we're going to see coming out of these rate cuts, initial R cuts, is some of that cyclical movement. But again, I do think in the next few weeks, I am a bit cautious. And I think if the market does pull back a little bit, it's going to be an opportunity. I mean, with the Fed cutting rates, now everybody's talking about the SOM roll. How about October around the corner here? When October's been the bottom the last few couple years in a row, we've ripped out of in tech. How about the IES rule? October by tech, there's only one thing about seasonality that everyone on the planet needs to know. No offense to the stock market titans, Jeff HS, all you need to know is that in 50% of the years during the last 100 years, the stock market peaks around December. You may exclude the remaining seasonality based on what you have learned. Jim, you had some really good interviews last night. I know we'll play some debtors, maybe from Rin Hos or Juan, but what's with all the hullabaloo? Our endless chat about AI, and I'm assuming that everyone else feels the same way, is about who needs Jensen and who doesn't. If you need Jensen, you're in trouble and you're worried about allocation. And if you don't, well, then you have a pretty good run of the place. Tan doesn't need Jensen. Tan doesn't need Jensen. Wong doesn't have to make things so that he gets Blackwell. But David, we can't stop thinking about the brief article you ran yesterday. Larry Allison mentioned that Wong needs to make amends with Jensen, and that is the true topic of conversation. Oracle's revival from a 2% grower to something far larger. Why they've done it right with Jensen Ellison, who is currently ranked second on the world's wealthiest list, overthrows Bezos and overtakes Elon Musk. The 20% monthly miracle will undoubtedly assist, allowing you to make the announcement. Strategic partnership between Salesforce and NVIDIA to enhance AI. By the way, I also adore Disney. All right, that's amazing. You are aware of God's love for you? Salesforce, NVIDIA, Ford strategic partnership. Advanced AI agent. So you and Jensen will have a fireside conversation. Yes, Jensen is coming here right now. Not only that, but my neighbor next door invented the GPU for Jensen, and he's here too. David Kirk is amazing. It's unbelievable that their original chief scientist is here by coincidence is my neighbor, and I said you've got to come to Dreamforce. Does Jensen subscribe to the notion that you, that agent force, was is what I was meant to be? I had a long conversation with him about it. He's been dreaming about this idea of agents. By the way, these are the guys who invented the next generation of graphics in 2008 and 2009. Do you remember the first time I bought the Switch, and I called you a phenomenal?